Good afternoon, everybody. It gives me great pleasure to invite you to this webinar on advances in endoscopy. My name is Tarun Gupta. I'm a consultant gastroenterologist as part of a cohesive unit of four consultants in the Department of Gastroenterology at the Hinduja Hospital, Naheen, and the Hinduja Healthcare Surgical, Khar. So today's topic will be advances in endoscopy. As we know, gastroenterology has advanced in leaps and bounds over the last few years. And now since smartphones and laptops have quad cores and octa-core processors, exciting progress has been made in the technology in our endoscopes and our monitors. Hence, progress has also been made in the branch of endoscopy over the last decade. Plus, there has been better understanding of interventional techniques. We choose our patients better, hence the results overall are much better nowadays. So I'll be just highlighting on a few aspects of advances in endoscopy because of shortage of time, and definitely welcome questions regarding this topic. So the first technical advancement which I would like to speak about is small bowel capsule endoscopy. Traditionally, endoscopes could only reach the first 3 feet of the small bowel, and a colonoscope would see the entire large intestine and the last 2 centimeters of the small intestine. But with this technology, now doctors can view the entire length of the small and also the large intestine. Basically, it's a small capsule, a normal size capsule, which contains a camera and a CCD CMOS chip. This capsule is swallowed by the patient, and as it moves down, it makes a movie at a capture rate of about 3 pictures per second. Recently, there's been a colon capsule launch, which captures high resolution pictures at the rate of 18 frames per second. And the technology is just rapidly expanding. So how do we perform capsule? The patient undergoes an overnight fast. The patient comes in fasting in the morning after a bowel preparation the previous evening to cleanse the intestine of all the fecal matter. Sensors, which are like ECG leads, are placed on the patient's chest, and they are attached to a battery and a data recorder, which the patient wears as a belt. The patient then ingests the capsule at around, say, about 5 to 10 minutes after he settles into the room. The capsule is ingested, and the movie starts recording immediately as it traverses the food pipe, the stomach, and the small intestine. On an average, it takes about 8 to 12 hours for the capsule to be excreted through the anal route. The movie is then sort of captured on a computer and then is analyzed by the gastroenterologist for any abnormalities. And it takes us a good 2 hours to watch the entire length of the film. So we'll just show a small caption of how a capsule sort of works in general. So this is a typical PillCam capsule manufactured by the company Given, and this is swallowed, and as you can see, as it traverses the small intestine, we can capture a movie, and this is how it actually looks like. This is through the small intestine, and we can actually appreciate the peristaltic waves as the capsule moves down its path. And any abnormalities in the lining can be captured. So in a common case scenario, a patient presents to us with, say, abdominal pain and weakness, and we find that the hemoglobin level is low. We find that the upper GI endoscopy and the colonoscopy is either inconclusive or normal. But we still have evidence of blood and stools either on a blood or on a stool test, or the patient can see it with his or own eyes. And a capsule is done in this common scenario for worms in the lining of the small intestine, and you can appreciate these ulcers. This is one of the common causes of chronic blood loss in our country. So other common indications apart from bleeding are detection of polyps, intestinal cancers, inflammatory conditions of the small intestines, namely Crohn's disease, which is an inflammatory bowel disease. It can also be used in the evaluation of intractable abdominal pain. And as I discussed before, a recent advancement is the colon capsule, which is now sort of replacing or trying to replace a screening colonoscopy, at least in the West, but because of cost constraints, it's difficult to bring it to practice in India as yet. The next technology I would like to highlight would be endoscopic ultrasound, which basically is a harmonious marriage between endoscopy and the ultrasound technology. Ultrasound has been traditionally performed transabdominally, that is from the outside, but with that, we are sort of restricted in the amount of frequency we can use. Hence, the images are not very sharp and crisp. But since this technology allows the ultrasound processor to be at the tip of the endoscope, we can rest on the wall of the digestive tract and see the layers of the wall and also the surrounding organs very clearly. Though this technology requires a high level of expertise and training. So there are two types of echo endoscopes. One is for the diagnostic modality, which is basically used for staging and defenses of the digestive tract and the surrounding organs like the lung, the pancreas, the bile ducts, the liver, the adrenal glands, etc. Another routine use is in gallstone disease, wherein we just make sure that the common bile duct, that is the tube draining the gallbladder into the small intestine, is clear before a patient goes in for a gallbladder removal surgery. The other type of echo endoscope is the linear echo endoscope, which is the instrument of the future. It can be used for diagnosis, and in addition to visualization, it allows us to acquire tissue. I'll show an animation regarding that. And also, it can be used in therapeutic interventions like drainage of collections within the abdominal cavity, drainage of the bile duct, drainage of the duct, and also in pain management. In patients with severe refractory abdominal pain, we can actually block the network of nerves which just sits behind the stomach, and that generally gives out very good pain relief for at least 6 months. So we'll just show you a caption of an animation of how an endoscopic ultrasound sort of works. So it's generally done like a conventional endoscopy. The patient swallows the
Endoscope.
tube
A cyst
and
can be identified, and a technique called fine needle aspiration can be used to sample the cyst. The endoscope used is a slim,
the
bendable
patient
tube
swallows
with an
the
ultrasound probe at the end.
endoscope,
It
and
enters through
as
the
we see
mouth,
it
travels
passing
down the
down the
esophagus,
food
and into
pipe
the
into the
stomach.
stomach,
From the
and
stomach,
the
the
yellow
endoscope
structure
enters the
behind is
duodenum,
the
or
pancreas,
first part of the
and
small
we are
bowel.
just arriving
At
at
this point, the
the
doctor
what we call
switches
as the
the
head
endoscope
of the
view
pancreas,
from the
and you see
camera
that
to the
brown
ultrasound.
colored lesion which
In
actually
the
is a
ultrasound view,
cyst.
sound
So we
waves are
examine
passed
the
through the lining of the
pancreas
stomach and
over
into the
its
pancreas to generate
entire
a clear image of
extent.
the
This is
pancreas. The
passage
ultrasound
of
probe is then withdrawn towards the
ultrasound
stomach
waves,
and moves
which are
along to
reflected
examine the
as
head,
black and white
body, and
images
tail of the
on
pancreas for
the
possible
monitor.
cysts. After
So this
thoroughly
is
checking the
examining
pancreas,
the area
the
of,
endoscope is
and as
positioned
part
over the
of
cyst that was
completing the
discovered.
workup, we
The
also
cyst is
examine the
carefully
rest of
examined to
the
detect any
gland.
abnormality. A
Then we
very
come
fine
back to
needle is
the
passed through the wall of the
lesion
stomach
of
or duodenum
interest.
and into the cyst.
We'll
A
just show you,
suspicious
and then
areas
there's
can be
this
sampled.
needle which is
Cyst fluid
acquiring
is then
tissue
sent for
from
further
the
tests. Endoscopic
place of
ultrasound
interest,
provides
and then we
very
send
detailed
it for
information
analysis.
about both pancreatic cysts and the pancreas.
So this again, we'll just probably skip this video. In brief, this is how it looks like. Black and white images. This is an image of a lymph node, collection of lymph nodes. This patient was referred to us for pancreas surgery, but when in our hospital, we generally sort of follow guidelines and make sure that we have an accurate tissue diagnosis before a surgical intervention is done. So we did a biopsy of this lesion and we found tuberculosis. The patient is doing absolutely well on medication and and unnecessary surgery was avoided. This is how the needle looks on a conventional endoscopic ultrasound image. You can see the needle length of the needle going in the area of interest, and just for your information, this is the bile duct and this is the duct of the pancreas meeting at one point in the small intestine. We'll just see some therapeutic implications as regards to advanced therapeutic endoscopy. This patient presented with abdominal pain and a swelling over the abdominal wall. We found it a large collection within the surrounding the pancreas. It was pressing on the stomach, and you can see this echo endoscope. We are placing a wire and then a stent and draining the collection. This is the end of the stent which goes into the collection, and this is the end of the stent which goes into the stomach. So the patient otherwise would have required a very long surgery, and this could be done within minutes with the endoscope for this particular patient. So this is what is called as drainage of a pancreatic collection or a pseudocyst. So another exciting development is bariatric endotherapy, wherein the patient whose lifestyle and dietary changes are not enough to allow him or her to lose weight, we can offer them endoscopic treatment in the form of placement of silicone balloon, which sits in the stomach and allows the patient to lose weight over a period of 6 months. On an average, they lose up to 15 to 20 kilos. And after 6 months, this is how the balloon looks like and from the inside. This is the endoscopic view. Actually, the balloon removal is more difficult than placing the balloon, which takes hardly 10 minutes and is an outpatient procedure. Here we are puncturing the balloon and sucking the fluid within, and then with an instrument which is called a forcep, we grab the balloon and then remove it uneventfully, and this procedure again takes hardly 15 minutes. So the patient again, we choose our patients who deserve surgery or endoscopy, and then since this is an outpatient procedure, so most patients are happy enough to undergo this kind of treatment. This patient saw presented with abdominal pain. On evaluation, we found that there is a swelling in the small intestine, and a biopsy showed that this is like a low cancer. Traditionally, this patient would have undergone a Whipple surgery, which takes about 3 to 4 hours and has a significant mortality rate and morbidity rate. But we are doing it endoscopically. We snared the lesion, we removed the lesion entirely, grabbed it with an instrument and removed it outside the body. And here we are placing protective stents into the pancreas and later into the bile duct to make sure that there is no complication following this excision of this cancerous tissue. So this is drainage of bile, which is coming freely, and we're just waiting for the specimen to be seen outside. Yeah, that's how it looks like, and this patient definitely was from a major surgery. This video is not being is not playing during this presentation. So this patient briefly was a young male who had ingested a corrosive in a suicide bid, and because of the injury to the food pipe and the stomach, there was extensive scarring, and after about 8 weeks, he developed narrowing in both of these organs. And previously, these patients were sent for surgery, which was again a thankless job because they would just tend to lose weight and not recover in general. But we used a special long stent, which was a kind of a novel approach, and we placed the stent across these areas of narrowing and were able to open up the entire digestive tract, and the patient is now doing extremely well. This is a lady who presented with abdominal pain and jaundice as a consequence due to cancer of the pancreas, and this is a small video of how we sort of palliated her because she was not really fit for surgery. So first we are doing an endoscopic ultrasound, we are seeing the area of interest, then we are targeting the area with a needle. In our hospital, the pathologist is kind enough to help us out with the diagnosis immediately after the procedure. So the diagnosis was established within about 15 minutes. And during the same session, the patient jaundice was relieved by draining the bile duct. Here we are sort of putting a slippery atraumatic wire into the bile duct, obtaining the outline of the bile duct by injecting a dye and opening the mouth of the bile duct and placing an expandable metal stent through the endoscopic route, and this shows the stent opened up and the patient's jaundice has since been relieved. So again, endoscopy allows such patients to have a better quality of life. So in conclusion, organs surrounding the digestive tract can be visualized probably better than a CT scan or an MRI. However, we do choose our patients carefully, and every patient has a plan in place, whether a patient needs to go for an endoscopic treatment or a surgical treatment. However, our threshold for offering endoscopic treatment is now getting much lower with advancements in technology. And procedures which would have been complex and prolonged in the form of complex surgery are now easily within the realms of therapeutic endoscopy. The costs are much lower. The patient doesn't have to stay in the hospital for a long period of time, and the patient can resume work probably either the next day or after a couple of days of rest. So now with this, I conclude my presentation. I welcome any questions if there are. Thank you. So Elena has asked a question. Procedure safe? Well, in a single point, I'll just make a statement is that we do a procedure when the risks are lesser than the benefits. So we choose our patients very carefully, explain and take their consent. And definitely the procedure is safe if the correct technique and the approach is followed. Every procedure has its own inherent risk of complications, and definitely with adequate training and sort of exposure, we definitely are on an as per international standard. So there's a question by Ms. Garima Agnihotri. She's asking for what types of diseases endoscopy is required. Well, that's a very broad question. So I'll just briefly divide it into benign and malignant conditions. It is primarily still a diagnostic modality. 90% of our endoscopies are diagnostic. Upper GI endoscopies are done for evaluation of bleeding, abdominal pain, vomiting. Lower GI endoscopies or colonoscopies are done for evaluation of, say, alteration of bowel pattern, like recent onset constipation or diarrhea, especially with weight loss. And we always look for an alarm feature, i.e. weight loss, bleeding, age of the patient, etc. Then there is, these are the conventional endoscopies. Then there is ERCP, which is a therapeutic modality, which is used to drain the bile duct, the pancreas, and relieve jaundice, etc. And as we discussed, capsule endoscopy is used for assessing bleeding from the small intestine. Endoscopic ultrasound is used for diagnostic and therapeutic purposes over a wide range of conditions. So basically, there's no straight answer for this. It is the gastroenterologist probably will decide based on the patient's symptoms. A, is the endoscopy really required? And B, and then decide on the type of endoscopy. Lina is asking, she's made a, typed a question, how long will the procedure take? Well, an upper GI diagnostic and colonoscopy lasts for about 5 minutes. A diagnostic colonoscopy lasts for about 10 to 15 minutes. We are very careful while examining each and every segment of the large intestine, and generally the withdrawal time is about 10 minutes. Hence, it takes about 15 minutes to 20 minutes to complete the procedure. Therapeutic procedures take a little longer. An ERCP on an average would last for about 30 minutes, and so also an endoscopic ultrasound examination. There are procedures, the more complex they are, the longer time they take, but on an average, we should be able to finish them within an hour. Another question asked by Garima Agnihotri is endoscopy required in general problems as well? Well, as long as the problems are related to the digestive tract, then the doctor will decide whether the endoscopy is required or not. As I said, if it's a short history, the symptoms are easily remediable by simple medications, then generally we wait only if the symptom is persistent or the severity of the symptom is intense, then we generally have a low threshold of offering an endoscopy. Another question asked by Garima Agnihotri, what are the limitations of endoscopy? Again, that is a very broad kind of a question. As for the mentioned indication in literature, an endoscopy for diagnosis should be successful in achieving a diagnosis in about 80 to 95% of the condition. The success rate of an ERCP is about should be more than 90% in a standard center. The success rate of an endoscopic ultrasound should be between 70 to 90% internationally, depending upon the area of interest and the complexity of the procedure. But generally for therapeutic interventions, it is nearly always successful. Mr. Venkatesh asked, do I have to stay at home after the procedure and for how long? Well, then for after a diagnostic procedure, you don't have to sort of stay at home. If we generally give sedation nowadays before the procedure, which is conscious sedation, and all that is required is that you're not allowed to drive for 24 hours and you need to be accompanied by somebody to take you back home. But you don't need to rest, you can go home, go to work the next morning. For therapeutic procedures, if it's a complex procedure, then obviously we would want the patient to rest at home for a few days, make sure that the patient has an adequate follow-up, and then advise regarding rejoining duty, etc. Mr. Venkatesh asks, what are the risks of endoscopy? Now, that again varies whether the endoscopy is diagnostic or therapeutic. The risk also is based on patient factors like the age of the patient, comorbidities, whether the patient has heart disease, whether the patient has diabetes, breathing problems, etc. But in general, for diagnostic upper GI endoscopies and colonoscopies and diagnostic endoscopic ultrasounds, the risk of complications is less than 1 in 10 lakh procedures. For therapeutic procedures, the main complications are infection, bleeding, and a perforation which is making a hole where it should not be. Generally, these are less than about 1 to 2%, and even if they occur, they are easily controlled with medications and maybe observation within the hospital. Very rarely do we need to send the patient for surgery. Garima Agnihotri asks a question, how does one feel after anesthesia for endoscopy? Depends upon the type of anesthetic agent used. Generally, we used a concoction of medication called midazolam and fentanyl, which gives you a lightheaded kind of a feeling. And by and large, you don't feel too different. It is a short-acting anesthetic agent, so within half an hour, you should be back to normal. However, your reflexes may be affected, hence you're not allowed to drive for 24 hours and or use complex machinery. There's another agent called propofol, which is given by the anesthetist, occasionally by the endoscopist if they are certified in cardiopulmonary resuscitation. And the advantage of that is that it gives you a deeper plane of anesthesia and gives you a lack of total lack of awareness procedure. So Elena asks, do the patient need to starve before the procedure, before the apogee endoscopy, before the endoscopic ultrasound, and before any therapeutic procedure? The patient generally has to be fasting for about 6 to 8 hours. But if it's a colonoscopy, then the patient can be on clear liquids till the timing of the procedure. So fasting is not required for a colonoscopy. So Mr. Venkatesh asks, is endoscopy like a surgery? Well, diagnostic endoscopy certainly is not, but it does give you a lot of information. Therapeutic endoscopy is now slowly replacing several surgeries which were done routinely in the past and now can be done by the gastroenterologist, especially with the advent of the endoscopic ultrasound linear echo endoscope. So in a way, it is like a minimally invasive surgery without a scar on the abdomen. Well, thank you very much. We end our session now, and I hope that the webinar has been informative. Have a nice day.